Harper Via and Harper Audio present The Tatami Galaxy, a novel by Tomihiko Morimi, translated by Emily Balestrieri, performed by Andrew Grace. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/pages/the Tatami Galaxy. The enhancement contains a glossary. It will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. 1. Tatami and the Obstructor of Romance. Let's just say I accomplished absolutely nothing during the 2 years leading up to the spring of my junior year in college. Every move I made in my quest to become an able participant in society, to associate wholesomely with the members of the opposite sex, to devote myself to my studies, to temper my flesh, somehow missed its mark, and I ended up making all sorts of moves, as if on purpose, that need not have been made at all. To isolate myself from the opposite sex, to abandon my studies, to allow my flesh to deteriorate. How did that happen? We must ask the person responsible. And who is responsible? It's not as if I was born this way. Fresh from the womb, I was innocence incarnate, every bit as precious as the shining Prince Genji must have been in his infancy. My smile, without a hint of malice, is said to have filled the mountains and valleys of my birthplace with a radiance of love. And now, what has become of me? Whenever I look in the mirror, I'm swept up in a storm of anger. How the hell did you end up like this? You've come so far and this is all you amount to? You're still young, some would say. It's never too late to change. Are you fucking kidding me? They say that the soul of a child at 3 remains the same even when the man reaches 100. So what good can it do for a splendid young man of 21, nearly a quarter century old, to put a lot of sloppy effort into transforming his character? The most he can do in attempting to force the stiffened tower of his personality to bend is to snap it right in half. I must shoulder the burden of my current self for the rest of my life. I mustn't avert my eyes from that reality. I can't look away, but it's just so hard to watch. It's said that people who become an obstacle to someone on their path to love will be kicked by a horse and die. So as a rule, I stay away from the riding grounds on the lonely north edge of campus. If I were to go anywhere near there, the unbroken horses would probably fly into a rage and jump the fence to gang up on me. I'd be trampled into shreds of soiled meat you couldn't even use to make sukiyaki. For the same reason, I'm also terrified of Kyoto Prefecture's mounted police. Why am I so scared of horses? Because even among people I don't know, I am notorious as an obstructor of romance. I am a dark cupid, costumed as a god of death who wields not arrows of love, but a battle axe. Red threads of destiny are strung around like infrared sensors, and I cut every last one in range, severing the invisible bonds between would-be lovers. Young men and women have shed barrels of bitter tears over these acts of mine. It's the height of injustice, I know. When I began college, even I sometimes quivered slightly with the thought that I just might have a rose-colored courtship ahead of me. And only a few months later, that was clear there was no need to so temper my resolve. I had even decided in my head, I will not behave like a wild animal. In the company of beautiful maidens, I will be a pure-hearted, proper gentleman. In any case, I should have had the capacity to turn a blind eye to those men and women who forsook reason to recklessly pair off. Instead, at some point, I lost that capacity and turned into the kind of heinous fiend who delights in the sound of red threads being severed. Broken Heart Alley, where snippets of red thread float in puddles of bitter tears. I stepped into this cramped backstreet of despair under the guidance of a detestable character. A man who is both my mortal enemy and sworn comrade. Ozu was in the same year as me. Despite being registered in the Department of Electrical and Electronic Engineering, he hated electricity, electronics, and engineering. At the end of freshman year, He had received so few credits, and with such low grades, it made you wonder whether there was any point to him being there. But Ozu himself didn't give a damn. Because he hated vegetables and ate only instant foods, his face was such a creepy color, it looked like he'd been living on the far side of the moon. 8 out of 10 people who met him walking down the street at night would take him for a yokai goblin. The other two would be shape-shifted yokai themselves. Ozu kicked those who were down and buttered up anyone stronger than him. He was selfish and arrogant, lazy and contrary. He never studied, had not a crumb of pride, and fueled himself on other people's misfortunes. There was not a single praiseworthy bone in his body. If only I had never met him, my soul would surely be less tainted. On that note, we must say that joining the Ablutions Film Club in the spring of my freshman year was my first big mistake. At the time, I was a fresh-as-a-daisy man. I remember how exhilarating the vibrant green of the cherry tree leaves was after all the flower petals had fallen. Any new student walking through campus gets club flyers thrust upon them, and I was weighed down with so many that my capacity for processing information had been far overwhelmed. There were all sorts of flyers, but the four that caught my eye were as follows. The Ablutions Film Club, a bizarre Disciples Wanted notice, the Mellow Softball Club, and the underground organization Lucky Cat Chinese Food. They all seemed pretty shady, but each one represented a doorway into a new college student life, and my curiosity was piqued. The fact that I thought a fun future would be waiting on the other side, no matter which door I chose, just goes to show what an incorrigible idiot I was. After my classes were over, I headed to the clock tower. All kinds of clubs were meeting there to take new students to orientations. The area around the clock was bustling with freshmen, their cheeks flushed with hope, and welcoming committee members ready to prey on them. It seemed to me that here, there were innumerable entryways leading to that elusive prize, a rose-colored campus life. And I walked among them half in a daze. I found several students waiting with a sign for the film club, Ablutions. They were holding a screening to welcome new students and offered to show me the way. Thinking back on it now, I should not have gone with them. But, "Let's all have fun making movies together," they said, and I was smooth-talked. So, blinded by the prospect of a rose-colored future, I joined the club that very day. I should have made 100 friends, but instead, I found myself wandering down a path of beasts, making only enemies. Though I joined the club, I couldn't quite get used to the obnoxiously pally atmosphere. I told myself, "This is a trial to be overcome. It is by boldly mingling with this abnormally cheerful group that I will be guaranteed a rose-colored campus life, a black-haired maiden, and, indeed, the world." But I was beginning to lose heart. Driven into a dark corner, I found myself standing next to a creepy fellow with a terribly inauspicious-looking face. At first, I thought he was a messenger from hell, only I, with my heightened sensitivities, could see. That was how I met Ozu. I'm going to jump ahead 2 years to the end of May in our junior year. I was sitting on the floor of my 4.5 mat tatami room, which one couldn't help but love, exchanging scornful looks with Ozu, whom one couldn't help but hate. My base of operations was a room at Shimogamo Yusuiso in Shimogamo Izumikawacho. From what I heard, it had been standing there since being rebuilt after burning down in the disorder accompanying the last days of the Tokugawa shogunate. There hadn't been a light seeping through the windows, the building would have been taken for abandoned. No wonder I thought I must have wandered into the walled city of Kowloon when I first visited the place on the university co-op's introduction. The 3-story wooden structure caused all those who saw it anxiety. It seemed ready to collapse at any moment. Its dilapidation was practically important cultural property level. Certainly, no one would miss it if it burned down. In fact, there was no doubt in my mind that this would be a load-off for its landlady, who lived just to the east. That night, Ozu had come over to hang out. We drank together in our gloom. "Got anything to eat?" he said. So I grilled some fish burgers in my toaster oven. But after one bite, he whined, "What about some actual meat? I want beef tongue with salty green onion sauce." He was pissing me off so much that I shoved one of the sizzling patties into his mouth. but then I forgave him when I saw tears silently rolling down his cheeks. That May, after spending 2 years single-mindedly wreaking social havoc in the Ablutions Film Club, we took the initiative to exile ourselves from it. They say a bird doesn't foul its nest when it leaves, but we fouled that nest with all our might to the point that it was as polluted as the Yellow River. I kept hanging around with Ozu as usual, but even after we exiled ourselves from Ablutions, he continued to be busy with this and that. Apparently, he was dabbling in a sports club and the activities of some strange organization as well. Even his coming to see me that night was only because he had been to visit someone else living on the second floor of my building. He called that person Master and had been coming to Shimogamo Yusuiso since freshman year. So the reason I had such a hard time breaking our fatal bond was not only that we'd been driven into the same dark corner within the same club, but also that he frequented my lodgings. Whenever I asked him who this Master was, he would only smirk this obscene smirk. I figured they must just talk smut. I was completely cut off from Ablutions, but Ozu, with his sharp ears, would always have tidbits of news for me as I stewed in my displeasure. We had staked what little honor we had on reform within the club, and now had nothing left to stake on anything. But according to Ozu, the protests we risked our very lives on had been in vain, and the club hadn't changed at all. The alcohol helped fuel the anger surging inside me. I was exiled from my club, just going back and forth between my room and school like some kind of ascetic, and I'd had enough. I could feel a dark passion being called awake, and Ozu was stupidly good at whipping it into a frenzy.
"Hey, that little plan of ours? Let's go for it," he said with a strange wiggle of his creature-like body.
"All right.
Then we're on. I'll come by tomorrow night ready to go,"
he said, leaving with a smile on his face. Somehow, I had the feeling I'd been expertly played. I tried to sleep, but the Chinese study abroad kids on the second floor were having a noisy get-together. I was sort of hungry, so I got out of bed, thinking I'd go get some Necco ramen, and wandered out into the night. That night, I had my first encounter with a god who lived on the second floor of Shimogamo Yusuiso. Necco ramen is a ramen stand rumored to make its soup from cats. Regardless of whether that's true or not, the flavor is unparalleled. It'd probably be a pain if I revealed its location here, so I won't write too much. Suffice it to say, it's in the neighborhood of Shimogamo Shrine. As I was sitting there slurping my ramen, wavering between ecstasy and anxiety over the unique taste, a customer came in and sat next to me. I glanced over and noted how strange he was. He looked perfectly nonchalant in his navy yukata and wore geta clogs like those you might find on a tengu spirit. Something about him reminded me of a mountain hermit. I looked up from my bowl, and as I observed this mystery man, I realized I had seen him a few times around Shimogamo Yusuiso. I had seen him from behind, creaking his way up the stairs. I had seen him from behind, out on the balcony sunbathing while getting his hair cut by a foreign exchange student. I had seen him from behind, washing some mysterious fruit in the common use sink. His hair looked like Typhoon Number 8 had just blown through, and the eyes set in his eggplant-shaped head had a carefree look in them. His age was unclear. He might have been older, but he could just as easily have been a college student. I certainly didn't think he was a god. He seemed to know the owner of the ramen joint, and they grinned while chattering back and forth about this and that. Turning to his bowl, he slurped up the noodles with enough force to make Niagara Falls flow upward. Before I was even done with my noodles, he was downing the last of his soup, a truly godlike feat. After he finished his ramen, he stared at me rather intently. Eventually, he addressed me in a terribly outmoded fashion.
"My good sir, you live at Shimogamo Yusuiso, correct?"
When I nodded, he broke into a satisfied grin.
"I live there too. Nice to meet you."
Likewise. When I left the conversation at that, he didn't hesitate to continue staring at my face.
"I see, I see," he nodded. "So you're the one, huh?"
It seemed that things were making sense to him. I was still a little drunk, but his oddly familiar demeanor was creeping me out. Could it be that he was my long-lost big brother? But I hadn't lost my big brother. I never had one to begin with. When I cleared my bowl and stood up, the guy followed, walking alongside me as if it were the natural thing to do. Then he took out a cigar lit it, and exhaled a cloud of smoke. When I increased my pace, he casually caught up without even appearing to rush, exactly the sort of wizardry you'd expect from a mountain hermit. Just as I was thinking how annoying the whole situation was, he abruptly began to speak.
"They say time flies like an arrow, but the way the seasons repeat one after the other is infuriating. I don't know when heaven and earth began, but it can't have been that long ago. It's absolutely astounding to think that humans have multiplied so much in so short a time. And day after day, everyone is doing their best to make things happen. Human beings are so industrious. I really admire them. I'd be lying if I said they weren't adorable. But no matter how adorable they are, there are so many that I don't have."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.